Well, good morning again. Good morning to each one of you. We're glad that you're here today and glad that you're listening with us also. Our sermon today is entitled, The Vision of Faith. The Vision of Faith. I'd like for you to turn with me to Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18. You may be very familiar with the text already. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18. It says, where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. Where there is no vision, the people perish. I doubt that you've ever heard of Samuel Pierpont Langley. Maybe you have. I doubt that you have. He's not terribly famous today. But if you'd lived 110 years ago, he was one of the buzz names in the news. Did you know that? Samuel Pierpont Langley. He was a scientist. He was a physicist and an inventor. And he had a desire to produce a powered flying machine. The desire to create flight was, as someone said, the dot-com of the day. It was the big thing people were trying to do. How to make a heavier-than-air flying machine. Now, Langley had the three things that were necessary to see a project being successful. If you ask any economist today or anyone who ventures out into capital, into the enterprise of inventions today, they're going to tell you there's three things that you need. You need money, you know, startup capital. You have to have the right people, and there has to be the right market conditions for your product to take off. Well, what about these? Well, Langley, he had a $50,000 grant from the War Department and was given an additional $20,000 from the Smithsonian Institution for this work. That was a huge amount of money in that day. In other words, he was very well financed. But what about the right people? Well, Langley himself had a seat at Harvard, and he was employed by the Smithsonian. He had connections to some of the most intellectual and intelligent people in the world, and he had the money to hire people like that. And he had, friends, I want to tell you, the right market conditions, because there was no competition if he was to succeed. And in fact, the New York Times, they sent people with him and followed him and recorded everything that he did. It was always reported what Langley was doing. He was a buzz person of that day. Everybody was rooting for Langley to succeed. But a few hundred miles away in Dayton, Ohio, there was two brothers working at a bicycle shop, neither of which had a college education. They had almost no money. Their names were, as you know, Orville and Wilbur Wright. Here's a picture of them taken in 1905. What were their conditions? Well, as we said, as far as money, they had very little because they only owned a bicycle shop. In fact, they actually had a machine shop. They did a lot of different things. They not only worked on bicycles, they were involved in printing. Did you know that? Working a printing press and doing some other things as well. But bicycles is what they're best known for. But they had no college education. None of the people working for them had a college education working with them. And you know what? The Times followed them nowhere. They had no notoriety from anywhere. But they had something that Langley didn't have. They had a vision. They had a vision. They believed that if they could invent a heavier-than-air flying machine, powered flying machine, that it would change the course of humanity. It would change the world and the course of the world. Samuel Pierpont Langley had no such vision, except that he would become rich and famous for making the airplane. And the proof that he had no vision beyond that was that the day that after the Wright brothers succeeded, Langley quit work on his flying machine. He couldn't be first. He couldn't be rich, and he couldn't be famous, so he quit. But the people who worked for the Wright brothers, they gave their blood, sweat, and tears for that man, for those men, because they had a vision. They believed in something that was going to happen, and they believed it could make a difference. They believed in this core idea that what we do for others is better than what we do for ourselves. And it said that when the Wright brothers went out to do their test flights, that they would take five pairs extra spare parts with them, five sets of extra spare parts, because they'd need that many. They'd have that many crashes before they'd go home for supper that night. And they just kept at it, and they kept at it. And so finally, in North Carolina at Kitty Hawk on December the 17th in 1903. They flew. This is a picture of the flyer, their very first flight. Someone was there to photograph it, and they have a picture of their very first flight ever. Successful flight. And they succeeded where Langley failed, because they believed something deep within themselves that would not allow them to stop. And on October 23 of 1844, a small group of believers had, both literally and symbolically, a vision. And they began something that nobody could stop, because they had a vision. You remember Elder James White? James White worked at backbreaking work when he was younger. I don't know if you know what a scythe is. I know Brother Leon's used a scythe. I've used a scythe a lot. This is mowing with a scythe. Before there was a lot of mechanism, and especially tractors and things, this is the way that a field of grass or hay would be cut down, with a scythe. And a good worker could scythe about an acre a day. That was considered the average working day. Just to give you an idea, if you know what an acre is, you could mow about that much in one day if you were a skilled scytheman. And of course, his scythe was different than this. His scythe would have what was called a cradle on it, too, if you know what a cradle is. But anyhow, that was what he did. And so James White would work at this to earn money, to go out, to be able to preach. And here's something he wrote in a letter that was written in 1848 to S. Howland. And he says, "I mow 5 days for unbelievers and Sunday for believers and rest on the seventh day. Therefore, I have but very little time to write. My health is good. God gives me strength to labor hard all day. I have mowed 8 days right off and felt hardly a pain. Brother Holt, John Belden, and I have taken 100 acres of grass to mow at 87.5 cents per acre and board ourselves. Praise the Lord. I hope to get a few dollars here to use in the cause of God." In other words, friends, they were so exact in their dealing that they measured it to the half cent how much their wage was going to be for that day. 87.5 cents a day, if that's what they were mowing on average. Now, I realize inflation has made our dollar worth a lot less today than it was in 1848, friends. But I want to tell you, it's not that much less. It's not that much less. I mean, even if our dollar is worth 20 times more, would you go out and mow all day for $20 a day? Well, if that's all you could do, that's what you would do today. If you really want work, if you really need work, if you really have a cause, if you have a vision, if you have something that's got to be done. Maybe James White's vision was seeing the Advent movement go, and that's what our main theme is today. But maybe today my vision has to be simply supplying for my family. You know, if that's all the cup I have, it's a small cup, it's not very full, but it's better than no cup, right? But Elder White went out and he worked for 87.5 cents an acre. He and two other men, they contracted to take 100 acres of land. That'd be about 33 acres each. So can you imagine these three men taking what would be maybe a month and or a month and a half's work by the time you add in at least the Sabbath off? And they're going to end up making not even $100 for the three of them, working a month to a month and a half. But Elder White had a vision, and no matter what it took, no matter how hard that work was, he was going to see that it got done. Do you remember a man by the name of Joseph Bates, Captain Bates, who sailed on the ocean blue, and when he retired, he cashed in his interest in a ship, and he had about $11,000. Now, $11,000, friends, in that day was a tremendous sum of money. And Captain Bates put this money into the Advent movement. And one day he got down so low he just had a few cents left. But his good wife Prudence didn't know about this. Prudence, for all she understood, we're still wealthy people. We have Captain Bates's great retirement money. And she went to Captain Bates and she said, "You know, I'm doing some baking and I need 4 pounds of flour and a few other items, some sugar and a few things." And Bates said, "Okay." So he went down to the hardware store, the grocery store, I guess, or the general store, whatever it was at the time, and had just enough money to buy 4 pounds of flour and a few other things. Now, we today, we might buy 4 or 5 pounds of flour in the little Betty Crocker bag or the gold medal bag, But that's not the way they usually bought flour in those days, friends. They would buy a barrel of flour at a time. You bought a barrel of flour, not just a little 4 pounds of flour. And he told the delivery person, he says, now when you deliver this, the woman's going to object and say, this surely can't be ours, but you deliver it anyhow. And so sure enough, the delivery man went, and Prudence argued this couldn't be for them because it was such a small little amount of things. She expected a barrel of sugar, probably a barrel of flour, who knows what else. And but the man delivered it. He was faithful to what Bates had told him. And so she went into the room, and she says, where Captain Bates was writing, she says, Captain Bates, she says, do you realize what's happened here? She says, we've got this strange delivery. What's going on? Elder Loughborough picks up the narrative here for us. And this is from the Great Second Advent Movement. As we mentioned, Captain Bates, when he left the sea, sold out his interest in the ship for $11,000. But now he had spent all his to advance the cause of truth. Up to this date, Mrs. Bates did not know his true financial condition, but he felt that he must now acquaint her with it. So he calmly said, wife, I have spent for those articles, flour and other items that she had requested earlier, the last money I have on earth. With bitter sobs, Mrs. Bates inquired, what are we going to do? The captain arose with all the dignity of a captain directing his vessel and says, I'm going to write a book. I'm going to circulate it and spread the Sabbath truth before the world. Well, said Mrs. Bates through blinding tears, what are we going to live on? The Lord is going to open the way, was Bates' smiling reply. Yes, said Mrs. Bates, the Lord is going to open the way. That's what you always say. And bursting in tears, she left the room. That's from the Great Second Advent Movement, page 252 by Loughborough. But you know what? The truth is the Lord did provide. That very day, Bates was impressed to go to the post office, and there was waiting $20 for him in the mail. $20. It's a lot of money in those days. That's right. The Advent pioneers had a vision. A vision of a difficult, obscure message going clear around the world. And it didn't care or matter to them how difficult it was going to be in giving it, because they had a vision that this was God's work, it was God's will, and it was God's message, and God was going to be behind it, and God was going to help them no matter what happened. They had a vision that built schools for missionaries. They had a vision that built sanitariums for the sick. They had a vision that even built a boat to go to the islands of the Pacific. They went from the simplest hand press that one could have to the most expensive, elaborate, and technologically great modern steam press that could be bought at that time and had it in the state of Michigan, because they had a vision. They had a divinely appointed vision. And that vision told them in Revelation chapter 14, if we could turn there, Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 and 7. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water. These people understood that they were to be this, as it were, angel flying through the midst of heaven, that they were to be giving a loud voice, and they took this seriously because they realized, friends, that it was the everlasting gospel that was at stake here. It wasn't just, we have a better hairbrush for you to buy. It wasn't simply that our product is better than Gatorade. We have the everlasting gospel. And God has said it's his message, and God says it must go. And I want to tell you, friends, that that vision is still in force today. But the question is it alive and well within you? And what are you doing about it? We've all heard of a very famous lady by the name of Helen Keller. Here she is with her dog, Kamikaze Go. Helen Keller went to Japan, and she was introduced to these beautiful dogs called Akitas. And she liked the one so much, she asked if she could have one. And so the Japanese government actually sent her Kamikaze Go as a present. And she said it was the best pet, greatest dog she ever had. When Kamikaze died, she said she'd never have a pet like that again. She loved it so much. Actually, when he died, they sent her another one. But But Helen Keller was a great woman. But you know the story about Helen Keller. She was blind almost all of her life. And someone asked her one time, what would be worse than being born blind? And do you know what Helen Keller replied? She said this, having sight without a vision. Having sight without a vision. Friends, we could have all the resources of the world, but if we have no vision, where there is no vision, the people perish. What a profound statement from this lady who lived virtually all her life blind. She couldn't help what this world gave her, what happened, but she could change the world that took her sight. Today the world is dying, friends, for lack of a vision, and we have it, and what are we doing about it? The word vision, it means sight, dream, revelation, enlightenment. But you know what the word perish means. It means to die or to expire. And where there is no vision, the people perish. The question we must contemplate today is, do we as a church, do we really still have that vision of Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7? Do we have this vision that our pioneers had? And what are we going to do about it if we still have it? Now, friends, first, a vision is the ability to see. Now, I'm not talking about what these kind of glasses do for you. I'm not talking about having night vision goggles at night. I'm not talking about what we see on the eye chart, the 20/20 vision, that acuity. I think what we're talking about can be summed up by looking in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24 through 27. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. How do you see someone invisible? It doesn't matter how good my eyes are, friends. It doesn't matter how well my glasses adjust. That's not how I see God. I see the invisible one today by faith because I have a vision. I have a vision of what God has for me to do. What we're talking about here is not, again, the things that we see with our eyes. What we're talking about here is that Moses had, as it were, a spiritual vision. He had never brought anyone out of captivity before. He had no clue what course was laid out before him and what things that he would have to suffer. He just knew that God wanted to show him a vision of something that was to come to pass in the future. Humanly speaking, Moses made a really bad decision. He decided that he would leave the palace of Egypt. He would leave the opportunity to become Pharaoh. And he would set his lot, as it were, with the people of God. You know, I suppose if you had just saw that at first face and saw the early results, how he had to flee Egypt, you'd say he blew it. He made a big mistake. That's what we would say today. But Moses had faith, and he could see. He had a faith that could see beyond the immediate. And even though he had no resources at his hand at the moment, he didn't even have a second follower at the time, it was time. Now, in Mark chapter 5, we have a story we want to read just a few verses of. Mark chapter 5. Starting in verse 22 through 24, and behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet, that is, at the feet of Jesus, and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And now if we'll skip down to verse 35. And while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? And as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. Be not afraid, only have faith. Only have faith, only believe. Don't be afraid, just believe. What was Jesus saying? He was saying, in effect, don't look upon the physical situation because there's nothing too hard for me. There's a spiritual vision you have that goes beyond what you're seeing happen right now. To the unseen, we have to, as Christians sometimes, we have to ignore what people say. Isn't that right? That's a crazy idea, keeping the seventh day. No one else does that. This idea that this motley little crew of people who believe this truth about God are going to somehow take this message to the whole world, well, it can't happen. Your resources are too few. Your people are too small. Can't happen. Sometimes we have to disregard what the world says. To disregard means that we turn a blind eye, if you please. Because after all, the world and all that the world pleases and does is going to pass away. But the Bible says that he that doeth the will of God will abide forever. 1 John 2:17. And so, friends, we have the choice. We have the choice to either look at the things that we see and be discouraged, or we can have a vision. We can believe the Word of God, that God says he has a message, that it's going to go, and just like James White, Joseph Bates, Hiram Edson, Ellen White, Loughborough, those early pioneers, friends, I mean, can you imagine? I think in their day they were probably far less equipped than we could be today. And yet they believed, and they went out, and they did. And God blessed. He honored their faith. Today, friends, we must not be controlled by logic, worldly logic, because there's more to life than, as we would say, meets the eye. We are guilty too often times of limiting God. But today, friends, I have a vision. I have a vision of seeing the work accomplished in me. Because the work can't be accomplished in the church unless it's accomplished in each one of us. And he that hath begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2:13. God's going to do it. And I have a vision that he's going to accomplish the work in me. He's going to accomplish the work for the church. He's going to accomplish his work in the world. Now I ask you the question. Are you using your spiritual eyesight? You know, there's a game that children play called Pin the Tail on the Donkey. You ever play that? Remember that game where they put up a poster of like a donkey minus the tail, and you have a little pin, and you're blindfolded, maybe spun around, and you're supposed to try to find the donkey. Whoever pins the tail closest to where the tail's supposed to be, I guess, wins. And sometimes it's quite hilarious. But I wonder sometimes if spiritually we don't play just like that. You know, we're just sort of blind, and we hit it, miss at whatever comes up. And we just expect God somehow to bless. But friends, God has given us in his word a blueprint. Through the spirit of prophecy, we have an understanding of how to operate the work and to spread the gospel. And do we have that vision? Do we believe that vision? And are we going to follow that vision today? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 7. Actually, what does that say? 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7. For we walk
by faith and not by sight.
That's right. We walk by faith and not by sight. Now that seems so contradictory. Because we're talking about having a vision. But again, the vision is not the things that we physically see. It's the things that we spiritually see and understand by based upon what the Word of God says. And so today, friends, I have a vision that this work is going to go and that we can be a part of it. And there may be things that we are dealing with on our individual life that we have to also deal with, you know, on a day-by-day basis. And it seems like there's no future, but friends, we have to have a vision of a future. And God promises to do that for us. Even a physically blind person can have a vision that is spirit-born, spirit-fed, and spirit-led. So how do we get a vision? Well, let's first of all turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." In other words, by beholding what? We become changed. By beholding, we become changed. And a good eye is one, friends, that looks at God. A good eye is one that looks at God. Don't look at the world for your vision. That will only teach you how to succeed in the world, or it will only discourage you. And neither one will help you to heaven. Neither one will help you to heaven. Once we understand how faithful and omnipotent God is by looking at Him, by looking to Him, we will not hesitate to believe Him for all things, no matter how great they may appear to be. He is faithful. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 23, the Bible tells that. It says, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for He is faithful that promised." He is faithful that promised. And so we are to hold fast. But not only is He faithful, friends, He is great in power. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 19, "And what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe according to the working of His mighty power?" It says that He has exceeding greatness. This word exceeding, it comes from two Greek words. One means over and throw, to throw over. It's just, it's so great. It's exceeding great. It's mega great. And His power is dunamis. It is explosive power. God has the ability to do everything. And that's why He can ask this question in Jeremiah 32, 27. "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for Me?" And of course, the implied answer is what? No, there's nothing too hard. There's nothing too hard for God. And so here He is. He is faithful. He has all this power available to us, power that can create myriads of universes. And He says, "Is there anything too hard for Me?" In chapter 33, in verse 2 and 3, "Thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it, to establish it. The Lord is His name. Call unto Me, and I will answer thee, and shew thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." So God, friends, is able to show us great and mighty things. And the more we look at Him, the more we see what He's like, and the more we'll have confidence that no matter what the vision tells us to proceed forward to do, no matter how impossible it appears to be, we can go forward. And He's able to do it. And so a vision is, first of all, the ability to see. And so I'm asking you a question. Are you seeing clearly? What is your spiritual visual acuity? Do you look at the circumstances, or can you look beyond the circumstances? Friends, I have a vision today of seeing the work accomplished in me. I have a vision of seeing the work accomplished in the church and for this world. I do. Now, to have a vision, we have to believe. We have to have faith. And Abraham believed, and he's given it to us as an example. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, that Abraham, what? Believed the Lord, and it was counted to him for righteousness. He believed, even though he couldn't see it yet. He believed in things, friends, that were probably far harder to believe in than we have today, because, you know, we have all this written word, because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing what? The Word of God, Romans 10, 17. We've got so much of the Word of God to read and study and develop faith with, and Abraham didn't have any of that. Abraham just had a few little revelations. A few times he heard the voice of God, just a few. But he had faith. He had faith. And Paul, in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 4, brings this out, verses 18 through 25. Speaking of Abraham, it says, "Who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. Not being weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that he which had promised was able also to perform, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, If we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. It says Abraham believed. It says he had faith. It says he had strong faith. It says that he wouldn't have unbelief. How much more could God emphasize it to us? This was the experience of Abraham. And he believed, and it was counted to him for righteousness. And friends, God will help us too. And we have, as I said, so much more to base our faith on than even Abraham did. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing what? Word of God. Where is that found? Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. And we have the Word of God, friends. In Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, they were asking why we couldn't cast out this demon. He says, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Now, I don't know about you, but a mustard seed, in my understanding, is pretty small. It's pretty small. But Jesus says, if you have this, you have this kind of faith, you can move mountains. And you know, we might not think we see any mountains move today, but friends, there are mountains moved every day. There are mountains of difficulties that we face, that we come up against. Well, we don't have enough money. We don't have the right people. There's not a good market for what we're doing right now. And you know what? The fact is that there's not a lot of money here. The fact is that we are short on people. And the fact is that the market doesn't want what we have, as the most part. We have an unpopular message. We have a message that most people don't want to hear. It's a message that involves the cross, friends. It involves self-denial. And that goes against the grain of the world and all who love the world and the lust of the world and the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. But we can have the truth as it is in Jesus, friends. And once someone is born again, they love this truth and they want this truth and they want to share this truth. And they get a part of vision. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, Paul says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, that every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. But I like the way that the New King James translates this, and it says it this way. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. In other words, we each one have a measure or the measure of faith. There's faith been given to each one of us. Remember in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, that Bible verse is famous because we say it's the first gospel promise, right? And it begins by saying, I will put enmity between thee and the woman. The Lord speaking to the serpent or speaking to the devil. He says, I'm going to put enmity there. Because you see, in our natural hearts, there would never be enmity. But now, he says, I'm going to put enmity there. And I'm going to put a measure of faith, the ability for every person on this earth to believe in their heart. So that they can hear my word and accept it. And they can see the vision. And they can run with it. They can go with it. Like the Father in Mark chapter 9, verse 24, we can cry out, I believe, help thou my unbelief. And you know, there's a text in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 13. It says, I can do what? I can do all things through Christ who strengtheth me. And we can believe that it's true, even about faith, even about having a vision. It's true. It's true for each one of you. There was a fifth grade class, and they were asked to go home, and they were studying science, a little bit about astronomy. And the teacher said, I want you to go home and see how many stars you can count tonight. See how many stars you can count. And so the next day they came in and they had various answers. Some said hundreds. Some said there were so many that they quit counting. There must be thousands. Someone said, well, there must be millions. But little Billy was over there on the side and he wasn't saying anything. So the teacher said, Billy, well, how many stars do you count? He said, three. Three? You only count three stars? He says, well, I have a small backyard. And you know what, friends? Sometimes we have a small backyard because we have a small vision. We have a small vision. We don't have a vision of great big things because we look so narrow. And I don't want to do that today. I don't want that to be my problem today in believing that I have a small backyard. Our faith needs to be strengthened, and that is through the Word. And friends, you don't need much faith. Faith just the size of a mustard seed can move mountains. And a vision includes a faith that believes. And I have a vision today that God can accomplish that work in me. He can accomplish that work in this church, in this movement, and He's going to do a work for this world yet. Now, a vision includes the courage to take action. Courage to take action. Courage is going forward in spite of overwhelming odds. And I think about David. The odds were against David as he faced Goliath. But you know what? David had a cause. David had a vision, something he believed in. He said, "This uncircumcised Philistine has blasphemed the God of Israel. And we cannot allow that to go on. And God will not allow it to go on. And God has promised to help us. And He's going to help me. And I'm going forward whether you go with me or not." And David was willing to move out of his comfort zone, if you please. And he went to war against the giant. And I wonder sometimes in our lives if we fail to go to war against our giants because we have a little comfort zone that we like, that we're comfortable with, that we don't want to take a chance on getting hurt with or to be injured by. What if? What if Noah had said, "Lord, I'm not a boat builder. Don't know anything about him." But Noah didn't say that. Noah believed the word of God, and Noah got the vision. And we are told, Noah's day, the inhabitants of the old world laughed to scorn what they termed the superstitious fears and forebodings of the preacher of righteousness. He was denounced as a visionary character. Did you get that? He was denounced as a visionary character, a fanatic, an alarmist. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. Men will reject the solemn message of warning in our day as they did in Noah's time. They will refer to those false teachers who have predicted the event and set the definite time and will say that they have no more faith in our warnings than in theirs. This is the attitude of the world today. Unbelief is widespread, and the preaching of Christ's coming is mocked at and derided. This makes it all the more essential that those who believe present truth should show their faith by their works. They should be sanctified through the truth which they profess to believe, for they are a savor of life unto life, or of death unto death. And that, friends, was the message of Noah. What if Noah had said to God, "I don't do boats"? What if Moses had said, "Lord, I don't like people, I'm not a leader"? What if David had said, "Lord, I don't do giants, and not much into kingdoms. I'm just a lowly shepherd boy"? And aren't you glad that Mary didn't say to God, "You know, I don't do babies. I'm not into babies, especially when I'm not married"? On August 24, 1963, a crowd of 250,000 people met on the mall in Washington, D.C. There had been no formal invitation sent out. There was no internet blogging about it. But on that day, Dr. Martin Luther King gave his "I Have a Dream" speech. And I think it's significant that in that speech, Dr. King said, "I have a dream," eight times. Eight times. He said, for instance, "I have a dream. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character." He said, "I have a dream that one day down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripped with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers." He said, "I have a dream. I have a dream." And I think it's interesting that when you read through the narrative or if you listen to Dr. King's speech, he really never told us what we needed to do. He just simply said, "I have a dream." He was saying, "I have a vision that things can change. I have a vision of what things should be like." And people came. and it's considered one of the greatest speeches of the 20th century of America, one of the greatest speeches of all time. Dr. King didn't tell us what to do. He just told us that he had a dream. He didn't say, go set up a committee. Instead, he told us what he dreamed, what he believed, what his vision was. Dr. King had a dream. He had a vision. And friends, you can't stop people when they have a vision. And I don't think I should let today pass by without reminding you that it was exactly 497 years ago today that an Augustinian monk went to the church in Wittenberg, Germany, to defend the 95 Theses he had posted the day before. His belief led to action, and he, like Dr. King, was one of the great emancipators of all time because he had a vision of people delivered from papal tyranny. Friends, vision is the ability to see what others can't or won't see. Faith to believe what others will not. Courage to do what others will not do or what others say can't be done. You remember Christopher Columbus, don't you? Everybody's heard of Christopher Columbus. Well, it was said that in his diary, as they were sailing across the ocean, the common entry for many days was simply this: this day we sailed on. This day we sailed on. What a wonderful motto for Christians. We've been reading on Monday nights in our story hour, Yankee on the Yahtzee. And in this, Professor Quimby tells a story about how they'd been withdrawn from China because of the war during World War II. And he was at Pacific Union College. He was the head of the religion department, and he was the local college pastor. And Elder Branson, some of you might remember, know of Elder Branson. He would later become the General Conference president. And he was the head of the missionary work in China. And they were going back to establish the work. And on his way over to China, he was crossing America, of course. And he stopped at Pacific Union College. And they invited him to speak. And, of course, he did. And he spoke about the great need of the mission field. Well, Dr. Quimby and his wife, they had been in mission work for a long time. And they were back in America now. They had bought their first house. And they were sort of happy. They settled down for the first time ever. And so, after the message, he congratulated Elder Branson. It was a good message, and Elder Branson said, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? And he said, well, I always want to do what the Lord wants me to do. He says, good, I'll be coming to see you very shortly, in just a couple hours. And so he met with Professor Quimby and his wife, and he said, you're going back to China. I have work for you there. And they went. And they went. They just couldn't say no. Elder Branson's enthusiasm for the work was so great, and he had it because he had a vision. Elder Branson had a vision of what was going to happen, what could happen. And I ask you, do you have a vision? Do you have a vision for your spiritual growth today in your own spiritual life? Do you have a vision for your children and what can happen if the Lord works in their life? Do you have a vision for your church, for the ministry here, for what we're trying to do? But most of all, do we have a ministry, friends, for the lost and the dying? Do we still have this vision of Daniel 8:14 and Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 through 12? Is that still our vision? Is it still relevant today? And I want to tell you, it most certainly is. It most certainly is. And I believe it, and I have that vision today, friends. And I want you to have that vision. And let's go together, and let's finish that work. We're told in the Review and Herald of November 26, 1903, we must have a vision of the future on the blessedness of heaven. Stand on the threshold of eternity and hear the gracious welcome given to those who in this life have cooperated with Christ, regarding it as a privilege and an honor to suffer for His sake. In 1963, at the Mall in Washington, Dr. King gave that I Have a Dream speech. 2 years later, he was down in Alabama, in Selma, Alabama, on that march to freedom. And there were people that were mugged and hurt badly on that. There were people who lost their lives because of those events. And later, Dr. King would lose his life just a few years later, 1968. Are we willing to regard it as a privilege and an honor to suffer for His sake? Continuing, As they unite with the angels, they cast their crowns at the feet of the Redeemer, exclaiming, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever." I want to tell you, friends, the angels in heaven have a vision. Our pioneers had a vision, and we can have a vision today. We can have a vision of the future, the blessedness of heaven. But friends, if we don't have a vision of finishing this work, we are not going to have that vision of the future blessings of heaven. And so let's take this opportunity now today. Let's see this work finished. Finished first in us, and then finished in our church, and finished in this world. May God have pity upon Israel and mercy upon us, friends. Lord, give us a vision, I pray. May God bless each one of you lots and lots.